Well, thank you, Daniel, for the nice introduction. Well, have you ever thought about adopting new API straight away into your own apps? Have you ever stopped this thought because you think, well, I still have to support older iOS versions? Well, let's talk about data sources of collection views today and dive a little bit deep into the new API. But to do that, let's make a collection view and offer a list of speakers, and we want to display an avatar and display their name and their Twitter handler. But before we start, let's first look at what does our data source needs to do. Well, our data source provides us data. We need to configure ourselves so we can return ourselves, and we'll specify the number of items and selections there are. So let's start by creating our model. Here we have a speaker with a name, a Twitter handler, and a read-only property called imageURL, which is an optional. And I really like this feature because starting in Swift 5.1, you can have a default implementation of the initializer. So we can call this method on these two specific initializers. On the first example, I can specify the image URL, but on the second one, I can just leave it blank and it will automatically be nil. And because we made our speaker a read-only property, and because we make the image URL a read-only property, we cannot actually mutate it somewhere else. So now that we have our speaker, let's create our collection view cell. Well, it's really boring. We have an avatar image view, we have our title label, and we have our Twitter handler. Next, we're going to display our view model. We're going to make an extension of collection view cell, call our method, which expects a speaker, reset a title, reset our Twitter handler, and for the sake of this example, I just imported Nuke. It's an image library using Swift Package Manager to fetch our image and display it nicely in our UI. Now that we configured ourselves, let's prepare our view controller. Here, it's very easy. It's just a collection view, and we have an array of speakers. Next up, we have to configure ourselves, and I really like to use this. I want to register the nip, and because I really don't want to make any typos, I use this convenient method of strings, so I'm always sure that I get the specified reuse identifier. Next up, we're going to display our delegate and our data source. But as you can see, we now have to provide our data source as well. And here, we'll just, in our cell for row, we'll dequeue our cell, and we cast it to our speaker cell. And if we cannot find it, we'll just fatal error because we made a huge mistake. So this shouldn't be any worry to have in production. Next, we're going to fetch our speaker from our speakers array, call our cell display, and return our cell. Next up, we'll have to specify our number of sections. The default is one, but for the sake of it, I also implemented it, so we'll have a nice way. And we have to return the amount of speakers that we have to return. Last but not least, we'll have to have a layout. And for now, I just give as a width, the collection view width, and a static height of 62. Well, I think we have everything right. Well, now we have to get some dummy data. Usually, you just do this by making a network call and fetching everything, map it to a speaker, and then display it to your users. So right now, we'll have a nice-looking app. We can scroll through it, like 100 users, and it looks really nice. Well, what about if you want to animate animations? For example, if we go from 10 items to 1, or if we're going from 1 item into 10, or even from 5 items to 5 different items, how can we make this animatable? Well, before we animate stuff, we'll have to dive a little bit deeper into how can we modify this. For example, we have 10 items, and we're going into 1. What do we have to do? Well, we have to reload our first item, because we never know if it's still the same speaker. And then we'll have to delete items 2 to 10, because they are all removed. What about from 1 to 10? Well, it's exactly the same. We'll reload our first item, and then we'll append items 2 to 10. And next up, we'll have from 5 items to 5 new items. We want to reload all of them, but we do not want to use reload data though because we do not get the nice animation Apple provides. So how does this look in code? Well, it actually looks like this. It's quite heavy, but as you can see, if we can just go try through it. First, we're going to take the previous speakers, so we know which how many we had before. Then we're going to perform our batch updates. This is a nice API from Apple, which allows us to animate our changes. Then we'll first look at if our previous speakers amount were higher, greater than our new speakers. If it is, we'll have to reload the ones that are exactly the same and delete everything else. Then, we'll, if it's the other way around, if we have less items than before, more items than before, sorry, then we're just going to reload everything that is on the same index pod and append, insert everything that is new. And last but not least, if they're not greater or not less, that means they're equal, just we're going to reload all of those items. But imagine if we had a lot more sections and a lot more index pods, this function would be terribly huge. I made a nice convenient method to map an array of ranges and call the map function to create an array of index pods. So we're happy, we have a nice animation, we'll run the app, and then suddenly, crash. Like, whenever this happens, I get really frustrated. This is so annoying bug, but thankfully, Apple announced during DubDub a new API called Diffable Data Sources. What they announced is the deprecation, the perform batch updates that we just do was deprecated. There are no more insertion and delete items. There are no more index paths, but instead we have identifiers. What this means is that now, with the new Diffable Data Source, we'll have a single source of truth, and we only use the method apply to transform our animations. But how does this really look like in real life? Well, let's look at the implementation of the Diffable Data Source. As you can see here, it's quite a mouthful. We have a UI collection field, Diffable Data Source, with a generic type section identifier and an item identifier type. But don't worry, we'll go through this step by step. Because even if generic scares you, if you just take your time to read about it, in here, we'll see the section identifier type, and there's only one constraint on it. It has to conform to Hashable. The same with the item identifier type. It's exactly the same as the section identifier type. The section identifier type is used for all your sections, and the item identifier type is used for all your items in a section. And here, we can also see the item identifier type needs to conform to Hashable. And as also, this class automatically implements the data sources which is implemented. So when we use this class, we don't have to worry anymore about the number of sections and the number of items. Apple will do that for us. So that's really nice. Can remove a lot of boilerplate. But now that we looked into the class, let's look at the initializer. In here, we'll see, okay, we need a collection view, and we have an escaping closure of a UI collection view diffable data source expecting the section identifier and the same identifier type dot cell provider. But as you can see here, the section identifier type is exactly the same as the one above. So that's the generic relationship with each other. And we have the item identifier type, which is also still the same. But what about the cell provider? Well, the cell provider is just a type alias of a tuple containing a collection view, an index pod, and your item identifier type generic. What this means is that everything, when we specify our generic type, this exclusion block will give us the specified model. And here we can still see the same generic type everywhere from still keeping back. But the weird thing about this, we can only specify one type. So for example, if we have a data source with 10 different cells all needing their own view model, like we're kind of stuck here. So how can we resolve this? Well, we can resolve this by making an enum with a tuple type containing all your cases with all your different cells, containing all the different view models, and you just specify this specific enum to your data source so you can switch over them and still have the nice new API. So But how do we use this? Well, let's first start by updating our view model speaker to conform to Hashable. If we look at Hashable, we have to specify, well, you automatically gain a lot of Hashable from Apple, but we want to make our speaker unique, so we'll specify a unique identifier. We'll need this because if your speaker is not unique, the data source cannot figure out how many items it has drawn, so you will get a random identifier. Then, to conform to Hashable, we'll have to say, okay, what property will make our view model unique? We can use multiple properties, but for now, I'll just use identifier. And because Hashable also conforms to equatable, we'll have to specify the equatable property as well. And for now, we'll just use the identifier type to see if the speakers are the same. Up next, we'll have to update our view controller. And because we're still targeting iOS 12, I also want to support like older versions. So I found a neat little trick that if we make our properties lazy, we can use the addAvailable attribute. So we can still use the same class for both iOS 12 or lower and 13. And it will look like this. Above, we have specified our section. And the nice things about enums is they're automatically conformed to Hashable. But if we added a tuple, we had to provide the tuple to conform to Hashable. But for now, we just have one section called main. Up next, we'll have our data source, UI collection view diffable data source. And our section identifier type generic is now our section. And for the item identifier type, we specified our speaker. And both are conforming to Hashable. The default value is nil, because in this way, whenever it's called, it gets initialized by nil. But now we can still use the same code base in our lower iOS versions. But now, we'll have to prepare our data source. So we'll create an initializer. I really like this initializer, because now you don't have to specify the generic constraints in it. Like whenever it's updated, you don't have to worry about changing this code, because the initial we can just call .init. The compiler will figure out which one it will need. Here, we'll give our collection view. And in the completion block, you can see we'll still be queuing our cell. We're giving a fatal error if it's not there. We'll specify our speaker. But the nice thing about this is now we do not have to fetch it from our own array. The data source will give it to us. And it's a really nice feature. So now we can even remove the entire array of speakers, but for now we'll keep the array there because we still want to support iOS 12. Because if you can see here, this is the old implementation, and this is the new implementation. As you can see, it's almost identically. The only difference is that you have a speaker here instead of you have to fetch it yourself. So you can make a nice method to move this boilerplate code into a nice method. Unit test it, validate it, so you know, okay, this will work for iOS 12 and 13. What's next? We need to update our data source. And this part is really important. We'll make a if available configuration and to say, okay, if we're on iOS 13, we're going to use the initializer we just wrote, and else we'll set our data source. If we set our data source as well, the app will crash. Doesn't like to have two differable data sources. So it's going to be really important that you specify that for iOS 13, you do not set the data source anymore. You can still set the data source for the drags or for the prefetching, because those are not generic yet. But for our data source itself, it is. So what have we done so far? Well, we have updated our speaker model to conform to Hashable. We've created a section enum with only main in it, remember, in our view controller. We added the diffable data source property to our view controller. And we configured the data source. But how do we populate this? Well, for that, Apple introduced Snapshot. And Snapshot is basically, like you probably heard it before in this conference, like snapshot testing. But now we have it in our data source, and it means we'll take a snapshot of our current collection view state, manipulate it, and then apply it to our data source so it can figure out what changed and do that all under the hood and animate the difference. Yeah. We can also start with a clean snapshot. So for example, if we do not have a snapshot yet because the collection view is nil or it needs to load, we can also just initialize a snapshot and then mutate it and give it to our data source. But how does this look like? Well, if you go back to our collection view data source interface, we'll also notice the apply function. In the apply function, it will need an NS divable data source snapshot with our generic types. And yeah, unfortunately, it's still NS, but which shouldn't matter that much. But you can use this on Objective-C as well. And we see that we can animate our differences, and it has a nice completion block. As you can see here, the section identifier type is still the same as the one from the class, and the item identifier as well. So let's update our population with dummy data, and this is a really nice part. We'll just create a new snapshot, only for iOS 13. We'll append our sections, it specs an array, and we append our items. But the most important part here is that we always append the specified section identifier type and a specified item identifier type, section and speaker, or else our compiler will not compile because it will say you do not have the generic constraints. But what about layout? Well, imagine that we have an array of our cell sizes to increase scroll performance. And we usually call this like return our cell sizes with the index path and item. But the problem with the divable data source is we do not know for sure that index path 0 is equal to our first speaker. So how can we fix this? Well, we can start by making a dictionary with an int value where we can store our hashable, because hashable is confirmed is an int value. And there we have our size. So in our array, we're just going to add our cell sizes with the speaker.hash value, set our sizes, and then we're done. But now you might wonder, but how do we get the speaker if we cannot use the index path? Well, if we look back to this class, we can see there are two different ways to fetch it. We have the item identifier type method expecting an index path, and this will return our specified speaker if it's there. But we can also use this the other way around. So if we have our speaker and we want to know which index path it is, we can give our speaker to the data source and it will return us the index path it's on. This is a really nice feature, so we can still use the old delegate ways with the new data source. So how will our layout look like now? Well, like this. If we're on iOS 13, we're going to ask our data source what is the item identifier for our current index path, and then we'll use that hash value because it's a speaker, and else if we cannot find it, we just return 0. You might not want to return 0 on production though, but for now, this example, I just return 0. And we're happy again. We have exactly the same as we had before, but now using the divable data source. But did you remember our huge perform batch updates? Well, how do we do this with the divable data source? Well, it's only 3 lines of code. We'll just first have to specify if we're on iOS 13 again. We take the current snapshot. We're deleting all our previous speakers. We're appending the new speakers. And then we just say, apply. And it magically works. And it's super great. What you also can do, because now we're just fetching the snapshot from our data source, you can also just recreate a new data source and append all your sections and items there and then apply that differences. The outcome will look exactly the same, but you will not always have access to all your data models. So that's why I wanted to specify that you can also use the snapshot from the data source. If we look at the snapshot more closely at the methods, we can see all these methods. We can append items to a section, before another item, after an item. We can delete items. We can delete all of them. And I kind of like deleting all items. We can move items before an item, after an item, and we can reload them. The same applies for section. We can insert items before an item, after. We can move them, and we can reload them. But you might ask, why do we still have reload? Well, if you want to expand a cell, you have to invalidate your layout, or reload your items so they can be expanded. What you have to keep in mind when you're using the snapshot, the new API, that order is very important. Uniqueness is very important. And if needed, we can apply from the background threads. But let's dive a little bit deeper. If we look at our function, like now I changed the order. Like now I'm appending the items first, and then after I'm appending the sections. What do you think might happen now when I run this code? It crashes. Like Apple fixed our weird assertion bug, but they introduced a lot more new crashes. So really, it's really important to have your order in place. Let's look at another example. Now, we're going to apply two sections, like I added another case to our section called second, and then we're going to append our speakers array. What will happen now? Well, nothing. We'll just see, like all our speakers will be appended to our last section. So if you had supplementary views, you would see your first view, your second view, and then all your items. So it's kind of weird, but it doesn't crash. Well, to fix this, we can just say, oh, append these speakers to our section. Uniqueness is also very important, and I will show you why. Let's say we're going to append the same section twice. What will happen, do you think? It's going to crash. Like Apple says, the crash message is very helpful because it just say, oh, the applied identifiers are not unique. Because we're giving an array of two items, but Apple can only see there's one unique, so it doesn't fit and it will crash. But what do you think will happen if we do that to our items? So we say append section main and second. We're going to append our speakers array to the main section, but we're also going to append the exact same array of speakers to our second section. What do you think will happen now? Well, we'll get a nice warning saying the 9 inserted items identifiers are already present. Existing items will be moved to the second section. So if you encounter this warning, the user might see a real weird expected behavior. So that's why you have to make sure your speakers are unique. Let's look at another example. What if we give the same speaker twice to the same section? So we have our first speaker, then another, again our first speaker to our section. What will happen? Well, now it will crash, saying the identifiers are not unique enough. So how does it work exactly? Well, if we look back to our speaker, we're saying that our identifier type is a random generated, and here is where the magic lies. We're saying the identifier is what makes our speaker unique. But let's say if you have it was a backend call, and we got all the IDs from the backend, so we didn't have our custom identifier. How can we be sure that the backends always return unique identifiers? Well, we can't. So we'll have to make our own unique identifier type. So let's say we have an ID in the speaker. In our hasher, we can just say combine identifier, comma, ID from the backend. And this will make sure that your backend model is like more unique than it was before. Like if the backend returns the same kind of identifier, it will not crash. Another nice thing about the difficult data sources is that we can apply it from the background thread. For example, if we have like thousands of items that we need to compare, the diffable, it can take some time. And when you notice this, you can just call the apply from a background thread, and Apple will automatically do all the differable data sort, all the differing, so the deletion, the moves, the reloads, the insertions, we'll do that all under the hood on the background thread, and when it's done, it will go automatically to the main thread and reload your UI. So how does it look? Well, here we have like a dispatch queue, call it background queue, and asynchronously we're calling this method. So this is nice, but one restriction that Apple provides us is that if we call this data source from a background queue, we'll always have to call it from a background queue or else it will crash. You do not have to be the same background queue, but it has to be a background queue. The same applies for the main thread. If we call it on the main thread, we'll always have to call it from the main thread or else it will crash. But what will happen if we'll just make three background threads? We're going to make an async of 1 second, and then we're going to call the apply. And for the sake of the example, I added a completion block printing the when they are done. In what order do you think this will execute? Well, the fun part is we don't know. Like the first time I run it, it got first completed, third completed, second completed, but it can be any order you have. So what I want to give you is like a warning, background queue is nice, but if you do it, be know of the dangers it can bring of asynchronously calling your UI. Like you never know, like if you're still waiting on an API call, applying your differences, the API call is done, also applying your differences, you never know which state is your UI is going to show. So now we have handled the cells, but what about segmentary views? Well, if we look at the implementation again, we'll see our the C implementer view provider is a tuple of a collection view, a string, the string is for saying if it's a header or a footer, and an index path. And the provider itself has the same constraints like the section identifier type and the item identifier type. But as you noticed, we do not have a generic model for our header view. Like, I think Apple maybe forgot about it. So, but let's create our view first. We'll have a nice title label, and whenever we call our display, we'll display our title, and whenever it's going to be reused, we'll just empty our title because we don't want to have weird behavior. Next up, we have to register our view. It's a nip, so I'll register the nip value using the nice convenient method for my string, so I don't make any typos. And now we're just going to specify our provider. It's like a completion block. You have your collection view, your kind, an index path, your DQ, your supplementary reusable view, and cast this to that view. If it's not there, I'll just fatal error. And here, I'll just say it's a header. But now we'll still have to maintain our own array of sections view models again. Like for our cells, we didn't have to, but for our headers, we'll still have to. But one convenient thing, this is exactly the same implementation you would have before on iOS 12. So you can move this into a nice convenient method and call that method. So let's recap. What have we done? Like the new API for our cell is great because we're forced to use view models for our cells, which separates even more logic from our view. Like if you heard John Sandel saying we need to abstract our code for future implementations, this is a great way to test out if you abstracted enough code. We do not have our custom perform batch updates anymore. We do not have to maintain it anymore, well, unless we still target iOS 12. And whenever Apple updates their API under the hood, we'll get all the updates for free. The new API for our supplementary views, it's exactly the same, but it's now in a nice completion block. We have a single source of truth called the snapshot. It is really great, so we can always get the current state of the collection view, fetch all our sections, fetch all our items, modify them, and apply the differences. And we do no longer have our custom perform batch updates. and for your updates. So I want to close up with saying, please try it out yourself. It's a real great way to apply your collection view updates with a free animation. And even though it's iOS 13 only, you shouldn't be discouraged to implement it, because it's, as you can see, it was quite easy to update. If you already have few models in your app, it's only like maybe an hour work to update to the new diffable data source. And if you really want to dive in further, you should look at the compositional flow layout. Grazie.